Greet you all in the wonderful name of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's a privilege of standing here, though I feel so small. May he be magnified for whom we are gathered here this morning, the Lord Jesus Christ. May we hear him only and serve him faithfully. Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we come this morning in that wonderful name of Jesus Christ, Lord. That name that is above all names. That name that is just a name in many mouths. That name that is just known as a byword in the lives of many people. But Father, we know that name is having an owner. And that name is having an owner, and his name is Jesus, and he's a person in our midst this morning. Lord, we pray that you come and speak to each one of us the things that we need to hear. Help us, Father, that we will keep our eyes on you, that we will keep our ears open for your correction, that we will keep our ears and our hearts open for your correction and your admonishment, Lord. Speak to our hearts. Help us, deliver us from our own ways of thinking. Deliver us from our own wisdom and let us receive from you this morning that bread of life that came and dwell in our midst. Father, bless us and I pray, let me not be a hindrance. Hide me, Lord. Let me not hinder your word that I so many times have done. Please, Father, I myself am so needy of you to speak to me this morning, that I be an empty vessel, that you can speak to each one of us and edify your people, edify your church, that we'll be blessed and encouraged and strengthened in the midst of this darkness that has come upon this world. Your word is steadfast and sure and true. Help us to hear you this morning. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Yeah. I'm thankful to the Lord. I'm thankful to the Lord that we can gather here. And we know we are not here to hear from a man. We are not here from one another. You know, the Bible says there in Timothy, second before we start with our main scripture, Second Timothy chapter 3. Let's just quickly, there in Second Timothy 3 verse 12. It's talking of all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So as we read through the scripture this morning that the Lord gave us to share, let us behold him, let us hear him, and let us be willing to be taught of the Lord. And willing not just to be hearers only, but to be doers of that. And let us be encouraged by the Lord Jesus as we read the life of Paul, as he's standing there before defending himself. That we know really it's not a defending of himself, but it's actually a witnessing of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's read there in verse 13, Acts 25 verse 13 on. And after certain days, King Agrippa and Bernice came unto Caesarea to salute Festus. And when they had been there many days, Festus declared Paul's cause unto the king, saying, there is a certain man left in bonds by Felix, about whom, when I was at Jerusalem, the chief priests and the elders of the Jews informed me, desiring to have judgment against him. To whom I answered, it is not the manner of the Romans to deliver any man to die, before that he which is accused have the accusers face to face and have license to answer for himself concerning the crime laid against him. Therefore, when they were come hither, without any delay on the morrow, I sat on judgment seat and commanded the men to be brought forth, against whom, when the accusers stood up, they brought none accusations of such things as I suppose, but had certain questions against him of their own superstition and of one Jesus, which was dead, whom Paul affirmed to be alive. And because I doubted of such manner of questions, I asked him whether he would go to Jerusalem and there be judged of these matters.
But when Paul had appealed to be reserved under the hearing of Augustus, I commanded him to be kept till I might send him to Caesar. Then Agrippa said unto Festus, I would also hear the man myself. Tomorrow, said he, thou shalt hear him. And on the morrow, when Agrippa was come, and Bernice with great pomp, and was entered into the place of hearing, with the chief captains and principal men of the city, at Festus's command, Paul was brought forth. And Festus saith, King Agrippa, and all men which are here present with us, ye see this man, about whom all the multitude of the Jews have dealt with me, both at Jerusalem and also here, crying that he ought not to live any longer. But when I found that he had committed nothing worthy of death, and that he himself hath appealed to Augustus, I have determined to send him, of whom I have no certain thing to write unto my Lord. Wherefore I have brought him forth before you, and especially before thee, O King Agrippa, that after examination yet I might have somewhat to write. For it seemeth to me unreasonable to send a prisoner, and not rather to signify the crimes laid against him. You know, when I was going through this, I was thinking of a man, of the life of Paul. You know, he served the Lord Jesus faithfully. After the Lord opened his eyes, he served him faithfully, that he didn't look behind anymore. He's looking ahead at the Lord Jesus Christ. And the life that he lives now, it's actually not him that loves his mouth, but Christ that liveth in him. And it will bring him, it brought him before men. It brought him before the Gentiles, before kings, before great men, if you can say, in the eyes of this world. He was standing before great men of this world to be judged by the Gentiles before this. And it's just a thing of our Lord Jesus. You know, when we come to a place of complete surrender to him, when we come to a place of surrendering our world and our life to him, that he be our life now, that he is our life now, what do we do? Does that bring us before men, that we can testify of the Lord Jesus Christ, that we can testify of the hope that is in us, that what he has done in us. And if we see in the earlier scriptures of Paul, there was a multitude that tried to kill him. Many they tried to kill him. Many they tried to stop him. Many they were crying and laying in wait for his life to be taken. This one man, look, a multitude that is against him for the sake of the Lord Jesus Christ. For the sake, and if we can read the earlier in the life of the earlier scripture, I think is it in verse 23, or Felix, when Paul was standing there and testifying, what does it say? He trembled in the earlier, the unrighteous judge. He trembled. And he said, I will hear thee another time. You know, he heard the gospel. There was a convenient time for him that moment when he trembled. When Paul was talking there, he trembled. But he said, I will hear thee another time. What do we do when we hear the gospel today? When God brings his message, when God brings his truth to us, what do we do? Do we tremble? Which is a good thing if we are outside of Christ, if we are not in Christ, if we are unbelieving, living a sinful life of unbelief, and we tremble. Do we make the opportunity that moment of accepting the gospel, of accepting the message, of accepting the Lord Jesus Christ? Now, do we postpone it till another time? Do we still postpone it till another time? What do we do when God speaks to us this moment about his son? When God lifts up his son in our midst, what do we do? Do we also tremble? Or are we accepting him? Are we believing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ? Are we believing that he is the one that we need? He's the Savior that we need. What do we do that moment? We'll come to that later in the later verses. Because this man, they brought up many accusations against Paul. And many of all those accusations, it was untruthful. They were lying. They were lying. They were just looking for something that they may kill him. Now, if we see that life of Paul already at the earlier year, when we are reading in the earlier scriptures, verses of chapter 25, it testified of the life of our Lord Jesus Christ also. It was exactly, there was nothing of different from the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because who are they really want to kill? They really do not want Paul himself as a person, but they want the truth. They do not want to hear the truth. It's an opposition against the word of God. It is an opposition against, the attack is against God himself, against the Son that he has sent. They do not really believe the Lord Jesus Christ. We will hear that later on. So many times, dear beloved, when we testify before men of the truth, do not accept any kind. Many times when you come to believe the truth of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you accepted him as our Savior, and now we want to walk in his ways, now we want him to live in us every day, our thoughts, our actions, every day, we will face opposition. We will face attacks, dear beloved. We will face trouble, trials. We will face all that for the sake of him. Because people, the world don't want the truth. They do not want the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, the Lord Jesus is used in many, in every tongue. You hear it out there, the Lord Jesus. Everybody, they use curse. They use his name in cursings. They use his name in everyday life without honoring him. They only know the name, but they do not know the one that owns the name. They do not want the one who's the owner of the name. And there's no fear. People have become hardened, dear beloved, hardened by this world. Now, I was thinking of many instances of even in the Old Testament of Joseph. There were many false accusations brought against him, things that are not truth. And those accusations made that he was cast into prison. He was cast into prison because he didn't want to go along with sin. He didn't want to give in to the sin. And because of that, he was cast into prison. But you know, even there in the prison, God was preparing him already for what lies ahead. God was preparing already through Joseph. And it was actually, if we see of the life of Joseph, it was testifying of the life of our Lord Jesus Christ, that who came to suffer for us, who came and went through all the suffering and died for us, that we may have life, that we may have eternal life, not just life, but eternal life in him and through him. Now, God prepared the nation, his people, Israelites, with Joseph. Later, if we read of what happened in Egypt, the same way it was with Daniel. What was Daniel? He was also, because of lies, he was cast into a lion's den. He was cast into a lion's den. Did the lions hurt him? No. The lions did not hurt. Not even one. Nothing happened to Daniel. That even that king had to run the next moment to the den where Daniel was thrown in. That he was with a lamenting voice crying out. And I'm just thinking of how he was crying, maybe with a lamenting voice. He was hoping maybe to receive fit to hear Daniel's voice back again. Maybe he ran with a hope to the den, because why would he in the first place run there? And Daniel answered the king, and he was glad. And what happened to them? They tried to, through lies, let Daniel be destroyed. Then they were thrown in, and their families. And before they could even reach the ground, they were destroyed by the lions. So much more, how much more in our lives, dear beloved, when we stand in the places of judgment, when we stand for the truth in the midst of the world that looks so dark, dear beloved, do we tremble? Do we become, when we stand there, do we have a hope in us that when we are called and stand before men, before great men of this world, as it seems like here, do we have a hope? Can we testify of the Lord Jesus Christ? What is our hope when we are brought in the same place as Paul in this? Look, many came there, great men, as we'll read also later. They came there, and Paul still stood before them. Did Paul stood there because of just any, I'm suffering for the gospel's sake or what? But did he stand in truth there? Because why? His life was not anymore his life. His life was not the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. It was the Lord Jesus Christ living through him, and he was just a vessel, dear beloved, because he knows whom he has believed and who called him. He knows who called him, and now he's continuing believing him, because why? He's always in tune with him. He knows. What about me and you? Can it be said the same of me and you today, dear beloved? When we are brought before men,
can we still witness and testify of the Lord Jesus Christ? Not just in word, not just because I learn so much wisdom that I can before men speak what I have read only and love, but is it because of a life in Christ? Is it Him that is speaking through us, dear beloved? Can we have that same confidence that we can go up? Because accusations will be there. If we read in Revelations 12, verse 10. Let's quickly check then, Revelations 12. 12, verse 10. Of accusations. That's the one that always accuses us. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of His Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. There's an accuser of the brethren, dear beloved. Let us not find it strange when we walk in this world, not according to the course of this world, but when we walk in this world, in the Lord, when we live in the midst of this world, dear beloved, for the Lord, and we allow Him. Yes, it's a work. It's not a one-day belief, dear beloved. It's a work. It's a way, and that way, and His name is Jesus. And when we are, as long as we are in Christ Jesus, we shall suffer persecution in this present evil world. We shall suffer revilings. We shall suffer accusations in this time, dear beloved. But what must we do? You know, we so much see that the world is at a terrible place, dear beloved. And by the world, I mean outside of Christ. Because God puts His people also, His disciples, the believers. The Lord Jesus prayed then, John 17, for His, I pray that thou should not take them out of this world, but that thou should keep them. Do we believe that He's able to keep us? Do we believe that He's able, when we stand and give a witness, that He is with us? When we go through challenges, do we still believe that He is with us going through that? And that's not for our sake. It's now for His sake, that His name be glorified, that He be heard, that He be seen, to bring men out of bondage. You know, if we can see our lives, each one of us, what was our life? Like in the life of Paul. Paul himself, meanwhile, he was standing when Stephen was stoned. He was hauling men and women into prison. The life of Paul, the earlier, before his conversion, we saw what type of life he had. And after God opened his eyes, what life of the life that he lives now. It's not anymore his, but the Lord Jesus Christ's life. What is our life? What do we live for today? Is it because of, do we live for the Lord? Or do we live for our own gain? Do we live for what we expect to achieve in this world, dear beloved? What do we live for? Are we living for the Lord Jesus Christ? Are we allowing Him to live through us? And I was pondering of, you know, even from the old times of the Old Testament, even the times of Noah, when God said that He must build the ark. He built the ark. People, they didn't believe. But Noah was faithfully busy. People, they were marrying, they were partying, they were enjoying. But Noah was faithfully doing that which God told him to do. It didn't deter him because he knows who he believed. Me and you, do we know whom we have believed? What do we do in the midst of that? He faithfully built, and the later, who was saved? Only the few that ended in the ark. Now, who's that ark today, dear beloved? That ark today is our Lord Jesus Christ. Though we go up, though we live a life, though we preach to others to turn to the truth, to turn to the Lord Jesus Christ, though we proclaim the gospel, the message of our Lord Jesus Christ, the gospel of peace, the reconciliation, and that peacemaking, it's not a peacemaking of bringing peace between people to people, but there's a reconciliation of men reconciling to with their loving God. When we are dead, when men are dead in sin, as we were also, of reconciling with our Lord Jesus Christ, that gospel, no one was faithfully doing that. So should we be in this time also. We must not believe and keep our eyes on every happening around us and be fearful. Yes, it's good that we observe. And what we observe in the world today, dear beloved, it's what's written in the scriptures.
What we observe of the falling away of many, if it's rumors of wars and all those, shouldn't make us fearful, dear beloved. Shouldn't make us to jump, take up our guns. And by guns, I'm not only meaning literal guns, physical guns, but the guns in our heart. We take up guns and then we want to shoot also. We shouldn't be busy with the affairs of this world, dear beloved. We should be busy with the Lord. And we should allow the Lord to be busy with us. We should continue believing the gospel. We should continue believing the Lord Jesus Christ. We should continue to be busy with the things of God. Though the world don't listen, God was patient with us, dear beloved. We were as dead in our sin also. But he was patient with us till we heard the truth and till we believe it. Now, what should we be? We should be busy with him. We should allow him now in this present evil world. The world shouldn't darken us or our minds. We shouldn't sit at the feet of this world. We shouldn't sit and because of fear, try to look for easy way out. We should continue persevering in faith in Christ Jesus. We should continue in secret with the Lord, outside, in public with the Lord. It shouldn't be one side only of in secret, I'm living my own life, and in the public, I'm living in the eyes of people for God. No, we should be busy with the Lord, because God knows that we cannot play a fool with him. We can't fool him, dear beloved, as we cannot fool also people that fears the Lord, that works with the Lord. You know, many times our actions, they expose us. Our ways, they expose us. But instead of coming to a place of complete surrender, instead of coming to a place of repenting in spirit and in truth, following the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul, he stood there. The kings, they came. King Agrippa, he came. And it says there that he came with a great plump. He came with a great plump, him and all the noblemen. Who came there to hear Paul? It was many. It's important people of the city. Did they come there to hear the message of our Lord Jesus Christ? Or did they come there because all the noble people were, did they come out of curiosity? Or did they come to truly hear what is the hope of Paul? Did they really want to hear why? Is it because of the Lord? We heard something of the Lord. Is it why they come? Or did they come out of curiosity? Why do we come to him? Do we come to him, to the Lord Jesus Christ? We hear him. Do we come that he can offer us a nice life on this earth, dear beloved, a comfortable life on this earth? Is it the reason why we are coming to him? To have a comfortable life on this earth? Although God promises us many beautiful things that already in this present time, we can enjoy those fruits. But why? What is our heart? In the first place, many of us seek God for the wrong reasons. Many of us, we seek God so that we can gain, so that we can have an easier life. Many of us, we had plans and ambitions for the future, of I want to achieve this and this and this. But God was not in it, dear beloved. Although, no matter how good it seems, God was not in it. It was just a man-made thing for man's satisfaction. It was nothing for the glory of God. And God had he planned otherwise. He planned otherwise, and he came and emptied us. He emptied me. He's emptying you, me, you, all of us who truly believe of our own ambitions. Because we can't be useful if we are still full of ourselves. We can't be useful in his hands when we still want to achieve God's ambition and our own ambitions. No, it should be God. We should live forth for him only. We should live forth for the praises of him only. When we say, praise God, with what heart do we say it? Do we say it with a God that fears? All that honor and glory belongs to him. But we say praise God because it's just a byword in our mouth. When we say give glory to God, with what heart? Because he truly deserves all the glory. Now many, they came here with great pomp. Wait, if we can read the verse. Why did they brought Paul there? There it says there. Against, therefore, when they, in 17, when they come hither without any delay on the morrow, I sat on the judgment seat and commanded the men to be brought forth, against whom, when the accusers stood up, they brought none accusations of such things as I supposed, but had certain questions against him of their own superstition, and of one, Jesus, which was dead, whom Paul affirmed to be alive. You know, they brought accusations to Paul, and there was no proof of the accusations that they brought against him. They were trying all means to find anything against him. But they were not having anything, no proof. And good in this fair trial, it seemed like a fair trial, that they were not given what they wanted. But the beautiful thing that stood out here is there in verse 19. But the certain questions against him of their own superstition and of one Jesus, which was dead, whom Paul affirmed to be alive, of that one Jesus. Then I was thinking of that. Is he that one Jesus, of a one Jesus to you, to me? Who is the Lord Jesus Christ to us? Is he just also a one that we always read of in the Bible? Okay, I have heard so many preachings about the Lord Jesus Christ. So I think he's the one. Is it our heart? Or do we truly believe that Jesus is the one that God has sent? Jesus Christ is the one, he's the Savior. That when we are so dead in our sins and trespasses, when we didn't want anything to do with God, when we didn't want to do anything to do with anything about God, God still loved us. And he sent us a son. And his name is Jesus Christ. And that son, he came and dwelt in our midst. He came and dwelt here on this earth, in our midst. And they rejected him the same way they reject Paul. They didn't really want to believe him. And there on the cross, when he was crucified and all this happening at the cross, there was one standing there that said, that truly, this truly is the Son of God. Did we come to the place that we came to realize also that truly is the Son of Jesus, truly is the Son of God? Or is it just a byword in our lives, dear beloved? Do we believe what he has done for us on the cross? Do we believe that he came to set us free from our sins? Do we believe that he came here, that we can be free from the bondages of those things that holds us back? We were separated. We are enemies of God. First, we must come to know that we are enemies of God. And Jesus died for in our place to set us free. His death brought our salvation. Do we believe it, dear beloved, that Jesus, who was dead, whom Paul affirmed to be alive, if he remained dead, dear beloved, there's no hope for us. If he just remained dead, Jesus Christ rose from the dead, dear beloved. And that rose, when he died, if we believe, we died together with him. And when he rose from the dead, we are risen with Christ. We are risen in him also, that we can walk in newness of life. Dear beloved, what is our life? What is the gospel? The message, the core message is Jesus died on the cross and he rose again. And we died with him. Myself, I died and he rose, that we can walk in newness of life. Do we walk in newness of life? What is our life, dear beloved? Are we living in victory? Or are we living a life defeat after defeat after defeat? Are we living a life of doubting the gospel? Are we living a life of, there was maybe a time that it was so wonderful, God wrought so wonderful works, God delivered me through so many, and there's a time that challenges, they come. With which ear do we hear the gospel? With which heart do we believe the Lord Jesus Christ? When the storms, they come, do we continue believing on the Lord Jesus Christ? And when we will be tested, dear beloved, when we hear, the world also noises. The world also brought a gospel. They brought a gospel. You know, the enemy is so, he can beguile us so easily if you do not love the truth, dear beloved. He can bring something that looks so truthful, that's so near the truth, but which is so far away from the truth, that separates the truth from the lie, so far away. So the enemy also brought a Jesus to us, dear beloved, a Jesus that we can see him only as a Jesus and not as a Savior and not as the Son of God. And then, because if he is the Lord of my life, if Jesus is Christ is the Savior of my life, what is my life? How is my life from now on? Even if the world come and make a noise, even if my own flesh try to rise up and discourages me, do I still continue believing the risen Lord Jesus Christ? Do I still continue hearing his voice, dear beloved? There's a thing of trusting on the Lord, dear beloved. Can the darkness hide him? No, dear beloved. His light shines still today. And he still feeds his people. He still, through the pastures, his pastures, in the midst of darkness, we must continue believing the Lord. We must continue believing his word, dear beloved. We shouldn't be alienated from his word. We shouldn't be discouraged from his word. We shouldn't be starting to give ears and attention to the systems of this world or to our own flesh or to our own thoughts. We should continue believing the truth, because God's word does not lie. The Bible says God has set forth his word and it shall not be written void. How do we believe that word? If God says something and he says it shall not return void, what do you do with it? What do I do with it? It shall not return void. And the one who has spoken that is one that never lies, dear beloved. That always, whatever he says comes to pass. It's for us to fall on his word instead of his word grinding us to powder. We should fall on his word when we still hear him today. We should continue believing his word. We should believe the Lord Jesus Christ. For he says, without him, you can do nothing. Here they brought accusations against Paul. And did it make him doubtful? Did it make him deviate to save himself? No, he appealed to Caesar, as we have heard. He appealed to Caesar, and to Caesar thou shalt go. And that's to go on the Lord Jesus Christ in the earlier scripture saying that thou wilt go and witness of me there in Rome also. So it's not a thing of that appeal. Although we can use the system of this world also, that God used, they are there in, put in place also to protect us also. But our main protection, our main focus, it's actually what God does for us. He is our protection. He's the one that protects us. He's the one, whether we have to go through the deeper waters, he's the one going with us. It doesn't seem that everything will run smooth sail if we follow the Lord. No. We'll go through the challenges. We'll go through the deep waters. We'll go through the fires. When we go through the fires for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ, do we remain faithful? Do we become less that we must become more? Because many of those fires that we go through is what we brought upon ourselves. Many of those fires that we go through, it's the things that we still hold on to that God wants to burn. Those things that we hold on, that bound that keeps us away from him. One side is pulling, still the heart is pulling to the things of the world, and the other side, no, the God is calling us to him. To him, to let go of this world, to let go of self, to let go of all. Many of the sufferings, it's because we hold on to the world. We hold on to things that we still cherish, that we think it's not really that important. The only important one should be the Lord, should be God, should be the Lord Jesus Christ, dear beloved. Without him, the risen, how is our life? What are we seeking after? Are we seeking after things above, or are we seeking earthly things, dear beloved? Are we living for eternity, or are we living for the temporal? Because the temporal will also lead to eternity. It will lead to eternity also, the temporal. But it's an eternity with God, or eternity with eternal damnation without Christ. There are warnings, dear beloved, that God is warning us. There are warnings when we say, I follow the Lord Jesus Christ, that he is not just in our mouths. He should be our life. The Lord Jesus Christ should be our life. Here, even these Festus, he didn't believe really. Maybe he didn't knew the old custom that he said of a certain Jesus. Is it a certain Jesus to me, to you? Who is he? Yes, we heard the gospel, dear beloved. Now let it not remain a certain when we heard the gospel in our day in, day out. Let it not remain a certain Jesus, because our actions, the life that we live, the things that we believe, how we walk on this earth determines whether we have him in our lives. What do we love? Do we love the things of this world, or do we love continue believing him? Can we in confidence stand there and testify of the Lord Jesus Christ, of what he has done, and that he wants to, the way he helped me, he can also help you. The Lord Jesus came to set captives free. He came for the sick. He came for the blind. He came for them who did not want him at all. He came for them who he knows already, all of us. He knows already who's going to reject him. He knows how we grieve him, his spirit. He knows all that. But still, he came for us, dear beloved. He came and died on that cross for us. He took upon himself that sin, which is us, our sin. Nailed him there on the cross, dear beloved. And the Bible says, if God, the Father, spare not his own son, he spared not his own son, dear beloved, but gave him up for us. How much more shall he not in his son give us all things? He has given us all things, dear beloved, pertaining to life, that we can live this present world, evil world, that we can live godly in this present evil world, dear beloved. Let us not be darkened by the world. Let us not be darkened by our own fears and doubts. And let's encourage each other on the Lord. Yes, we were tested many times of giving up. It's so easy for us to say, yes, for the Lord, I want to give up. But when we give up, when we are tested on that, then we realize, oh, it's so difficult to give up. Then how did we believe? Because God cannot use us if we still hold on to ourselves, to our own ambitions. He has purchased us with his own blood, dear beloved. He has purchased us with that we can live forth for him. Because God knows the world doesn't have anything good to offer us. There's nothing good in this world, dear beloved. There's nothing good in my own flesh, dear beloved. There's nothing good dwelling in my own flesh. He knows. Why don't we just but quit and live, allow him to prune us? Yes, many times it's painful, dear beloved. But it's more painful the longer we hold on. It's more painful the longer we keep holding on and keep rejecting and resisting. It's more painful. It becomes more painful instead of let go. Let go, dear beloved. And now we let go. Now we start to doubt. Was it really the Lord? We started to doubt. We shouldn't we encourage each other when we suffer for his name's sake? Shouldn't we encourage one another in the Lord? As David in the Old Testament, he went through trials, he went through rejection, he went through pains and sufferings. What did he do? He strengthened himself in the Lord. He encouraged himself in the Lord. And many times when we go through that, let's keep our eyes not on the storms. Let's keep our eyes not on how big and how dark the world is, how big and the unbelief is. But let's keep our eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ, who has promised us, who has called us, dear beloved, to himself. He is saying in verse 20, and because I doubted of such manner of questions, I asked him whether he would go to Jerusalem and there be judge of these matters. But when Paul did appeal to be reserved under the hearing of officers, I commanded him to be kept till I might send him to Caesar. You know, here the Jews, they were hoping that Paul must be given, he must be found guilty, and they must be given Paul. They wanted Paul to go back to Jerusalem and judge there. But if God is having a plan with your life, dear beloved, when we follow him and he's having a plan with his life, no matter what the enemy will try to do, God will still direct our steps. That's why we should be in tune with God, with the will of God. We should be hearing his voice all the time. What does the Lord require of me? What does the Lord require of you? What do I want? Why am I living for here? Am I any more on this earth for myself? Or am I here for him, dear beloved? Because God, there, although he was in prison, if we see all those men before whom Paul came and stood, it's great men, great people, the important people of the town. They were the important people of the town. But if we can say who was really a prisoner, Paul standing there, he was free. Free in a sense of he wasn't in bond of sin. He was free from himself. He was, let me say, if we say a prisoner of the Lord, and that's a thing of you want to be a prisoner rather of the Lord. It's a joy to be a prisoner of the Lord because we know really what that means if we truly have him. Instead of being a prisoner of this world, Paul was actually free. Paul was the one that had, that was the, if we say it in the sense of importance, Paul was the one that was truly in a place of importance there and not the rest that came and hear the accusations and hear all those things that was thrown at him. Paul was really the one that, if we could say that, is important because why? He had the Lord. He had God. He had the true God. Not just a God. Not just a certain Jesus, but the truth. And his name is Jesus, the righteous. So, what do we live for, dear beloved? Is the Lord Jesus Christ important to us? Did he liberate us? Did he set us free that we can follow him? It's one thing of being set free from bondage of sin, and then we are in the pastures, wandering there in the pastures, and then we see the wolves coming. Are we staying next to the edge where we can easily be attacked? Shouldn't we be there on the fruitful ground where God tells us to remain? Or are we first because now the Lord saved me, now I'm strong enough. Now I can maybe go to the edge and see what's going on there, next to the edge. Now I'm strong. Now the Lord said, no, God is with me. Are we reasoning that way? Are we say, are we continue staying close to the Lord Jesus Christ? Are we continue staying with him? Are we continue letting him wash our feet, dear beloved? Because in this world that we live, there's a lot of dust. We hear things that we are not supposed to hear. We see things that we are not supposed to see. We are confronted by things
out there, dear beloved, and do we come to a place of letting the Lord wash us, that this dust cannot gather too much. Every time, what do? Do we allow him to wash us? Do we allow us to cleanse us from ourselves? Here in Festus, in verse 24, and Festus said, King Agrippa and all men which are here present with us, you see this man about whom all the multitude of the Jews dealt with me, both at Jerusalem and also here, crying that he ought not to live any longer. These men, they thought they were doing God a service when they were saying, they were screaming the same, away with him. They wanted to kill him. They thought they were in right place with God and they were doing God a favor. That should be blindless, dear beloved. Shouldn't it be a warning also to us when we walk after the flesh? Shouldn't it be a warning to us also when we allow the world and the flesh to be our guide and our counsel? Shouldn't it be a warning that it can also blind us, dear beloved? Many times we see people, even in our own lives, when we walk close with God, we enjoy his presence. And there were things that we know this was wrong in the eyes of God. And we were running or keeping much as possible away from everything that we know is grieving him. But gradually, when we allow the enemy to whisper to us different things from different angles, and little bit by little bit, we took in the doctrines of this world, little bit by little bit, our minds are darkened, dear beloved. That the same things that we really had, that we are so standing on the word, that this is wrong, the same things are no more that wrong. It's no more that important. It's like we became so calm in the deceit, calm in our wrong thinking, way of thinking, that there's nothing like, let me say, a murder of a hatred of sin, that murderous hatred for sin. It crept in, and later we became so accustomed, so lukewarm, little bit by little bit. And we continue in that, dear beloved. Why? Because we do not love the truth. Because maybe the Lord spoke to us at a certain time and we hardened our hearts. We hardened our hearts that we became so blinded, thinking that although we will not say, away with him, I will not kill the Lord Jesus Christ. But we have silenced his voice. We have made him a prisoner if we do not believe. And we bit by bit allow the world and its doctrine and the flesh. If we have silenced him. We have put him in a prison. He wants to speak forth. He wants to help us. He wants to direct our lives. But yes, we have silenced him. Why? Because we thought really, sin is not sin. It's just a thought. It's just a word. It's just an action. It's small. Dear beloved, be careful of those small things. Those small things, they can make us blind. Those smaller things that we think it's not important, it's very dangerous, dear beloved. The Bible says we will give account of every thought, not only what we have done, but even by every idle word, every idle, those things, we will give account on judgment day. Before the true judge, these are earthly judges before Paul appears, but they themselves, they will stand before a true judge. What account will we give? What escape will we say that day? What is our, what? Why will God say, well done, good and faithful servant, that day? Is it because of all the effort that we put in here? Is it because of what I have done? Of, no, Lord, I believe you because you said like this and I did exactly what you said. Why will the Lord say to you and me that day, well done, come into my rest, that day, when we stand before him? Why will he not condemn us, dear beloved? That's a question to each one of us. Is it because of what we do? Or because how faithfully we keep him, his laws? Or is it because of what he has done, dear beloved? As you read earlier, of the one that many see as a certain Jesus. Who is that certain Jesus to you and me? Is he the Savior? Is he the one that purchased us with his own blood? Is he the one that set us free? Is he the one that direct our lives every day? Is he the one that for whom we purify our lives daily? Is he the one for whom that we purify, live our life following him in this present time, dear beloved? Is the one who died and I died with him and he's risen? Is the risen Lord Jesus Christ that is seated at the seat of right hand of God? Which one do I believe? Who is he to me? Is he a precious Redeemer? Is he a precious Savior?
Redeemer, when it says redeem, he has bought us. We were in bondage. He set us free. Now we are his. I heard of an account of a woman who was bought those times of slaves, and she was set free. The master bought her, and she was set free. But she was angry with the master, and she was very upset with him, because I think she belonged to somebody else, and he bought her. And from there, she thought now she belonged to him, that she was him. But he said, no, I bought you. You are free now. You are free to go. You are no more a slave. You are free. What did that woman do? She turned and she wanted to follow him, because he has set us. It is a willing heart that wants to follow. Because why? He did something for me. The same with our Lord Jesus Christ, dear beloved. He has set us free not to live for self anymore. That we really want to follow him. That we really, if we have to go through the fires, we want to go through those fires for him. If we really want to go through the storms, we really want to go through for him, through the floods. That same Jesus that is alive forevermore, dear beloved. And here they are saying in verse 25, but when I found that he had committed nothing worthy of death, nothing worthy of death, how is our life when we are brought before the council? Is there any guilt? Are we brought before the council of our wrong ways? Are we brought before the council of our wrong actions? Or are we brought before the council that people can check, the judges of the earth can check with their magnifying glasses, and they see nothing wrong worthy of death, dear beloved? Nothing wrong worthy of death. And shouldn't be. There's only one place where there's really nothing wrong of dying for. When we know that he has paid the price and he has purchased us with his blood, dear beloved. And we believe that the cross, yeah, Paul, all these men, all these judges, these Festus, Agrippa, and even Felix, the earlier ones, they heard the truth. They heard the truth. There was how many opportunities are there that the truth of our Lord Jesus Christ is being echoed? To some, it may be in pretense. Some, it may be in truth, but they heard the truth. What do we do? They cannot have an excuse one day before the judge. Before the judge, they cannot have an excuse. All of them, how many opportunities was there? Even the great and important men that came here with a plump, as it says there, with King Agrippa and Bernice and Festus, all of them, they heard the Lord Jesus Christ. When we stand there, what is our witness? What do we witness? What do we testify of when we stand there? When we are standing before people, when we go out there, dear beloved, what is our life? What do we speak of? Are we speaking of worldly things, worldly ambitions? Are we speaking of the things of this world? Or are we speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ testifying? And we can speak there if we know that what he has done to us. Did he do a work in you, in me? Did he start to do a work in me or in you? What do we testify of, dear beloved? May we be encouraged by the Lord. Here it's saying, verse 26, of whom I have no certain thing to write unto you, unto my Lord. Wherefore I have brought him forth before you, and especially before thee, O King Agrippa, that after examination I might have somewhat to write. He's looking for, is there really an accusation? Is there something worthy of death that I can write here when Paul, so that I can send the prisoner, so that he can send the prisoner with a valid accusation. Come again.
It's crime. Valid crime.
Yeah, with a valid crime, yeah. Is there a valid crime that he can write there and say, okay, this he appealed to Caesar, so this is his crime that he has committed. So it's very difficult for him also to find anything worthy of death. Though the Jews wanted him. But he had to go because the Lord said he will go and testify. It's not because of a crime that he will go there. It is not because, no matter what, he may not find Festus, Paul will still go and witness of the Lord Jesus Christ in Rome, because it's what the Lord has said. He will go and stand there again. And we know it's nearing to the end of his life there, when you go there, after a couple of years maybe. But so beautiful that we can be encouraged of not fearing, dear beloved, not doubting, when we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And when he said, pick up your cross and follow me. And when we, because of that,
We face challenges. We stand before men. What do we do? Are we still witnessing of you? With joy, dear beloved, not with a doubt, not with a heart of maybe, is there maybe, or are we assured of whom we are witnessing of? Are we assured of the risen Lord Jesus Christ who rose from the dead, who's sitting at the right hand of God, who's very much involved in my life and in your life, if we truly believe, who's very much involved in this present time, dear beloved, that we can testify of him still. Because he has not left us alone. He has promised us that he will be with us, dear beloved. So sometimes it may seem dark. Sometimes it may seem difficult. But when we believe, let's continue believing. Let us not be discouraged by the blindness of the multitude, dear beloved, of trying to make us doubt God's word. It shouldn't be the more in this time. God says, when the enemy will come like a flood, or like a flood, God will raise up a standard, dear beloved. He will raise up a standard, and he will deliver us. He will guide us. He will lead us. And sometimes, yes, we will go to unpleasant places for his sake, dear beloved. It should be a thing of our life is no more ours. It should be him living through us. It should be him that we can be useful in his hand, that he can speak to us any moment, that he can direct our steps any moment. Because now it shouldn't be about me anymore. Let go. Let's let go, dear beloved, of the things. Let's let go of those cords that pulls us back away from God. Let's let go. Let's trust him. Let's continue encouraging one another. Let us not be doubtful when we see struggles among us because of not sin, but because of for the truth. Let us encourage each other in the Lord. Let us encourage each other in his truth. Let us encourage each other in the Lord Jesus Christ. He is faithful, who has promised. May we be encouraged and not doubt. God is still speaking today. His word, his light is still shining in the hearts of them that believe him. He doesn't leave them alone. Let us turn our hearts away from this world and towards God wholeheartedly, who has bought us with his own blood. Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, I pray this morning, and thank you for this message, Lord. Father, you know what each one of us wanted to hear. Father, if there be anything I may have said amiss, Lord, please forgive me. And Father, if there's anything I left out, Lord, let your spirit be the after preacher, Lord, and speak to each one of us. Father, we are here to you, for you only, Lord. We want to hear and be encouraged and be corrected and be strengthened by you, that we'll continue believing your word and not on the masses, Lord. Let us be part of the few that walks on the narrow way and not the multitude that is on the broad way that leads to destruction. And Father, let us live, help us to live lives that is crucified in Christ, Lord, that no longer we live, but that you, Christ Jesus, live in us, and that the life that we live now in the flesh, it's to the glory of God. Please help us, Father, to remember the things that you are teaching us in secret. Father, help us, Lord, to remember also your encouragements there in secret before the storms they come, that the storms will not darken our minds, but that we will continue rejoicing when we suffer for your name's sake, that we will come to repentance where you show us wrongs in our lives, Father, that we will not harden our hearts, but that we will surrender every thought, Lord, our world, our plans, our future unto you, Lord. Father, be with each one of us, be with them who couldn't be here, the sick, Lord, Father, please reach out, Father, where men's hands and words cannot reach out, Lord Father, for we depend on you, and without you we can do nothing. Thank you for our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for the Savior. Thank you for your love towards us. In Jesus Christ's name we pray thee. Amen.